This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive, and I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it, and when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper Talk this is.
Let's introduce Ward Silver, N0 Alpha X-Ray, a new generation of ham radio technology, fun, and relationships.
Thank you. Glad to be here. Glad to be anywhere at my age, so you know, we're all good. Echoing what Steve said, blenders need a setting called kitten. So we've had a lot of excitement at the house, and the old cat's still pissed, so whatever. Okay, new generation of ham radio. I changed the title a little bit on this from what's in your guide. I've decided to put fun up first. This is fun. We're all here because this is fun one way or the other. And, you know, that's where we have to kind of keep the good arrow pointing toward fun. So maybe some of you saw me a few years ago, 2015, I gave the talk, a keynote talk to this conference called Ham Radio Now What? And you can find that on Gary's site. It's presentation number 242, I think. And it talks about, you know, we've had this great 100-year run, where are we going to go? And since then, things are changing. We're in this transition period between what I call Ham Radio 1.0 and Ham Radio 2.0. We're getting past a lot of previous standards like the radiogram. You know, when was the last time you guys received or filled out a radiogram? You know, that's probably been decades in many cases, but we're moving beyond the radiogram. NTS is repurposing itself. We still need to move data around, but we're probably not going to do it on 80-meter phone nets. RTTY, it's been around for 100 years. What comes next? Bulletins. When was the last time you copied a bulletin off the air? Been quite a while, I'm sure. So we're getting to new standards. YouTube, ham, net, online stuff, Facebook, all these things. We have these new ways of doing things. And we have WinLink, we have WinMore, we have these big systems. The system is now where innovation is occurring. People are using these great tools to build these wonderful systems that can do amazing things that they could not do before, like the reverse beacon network, that sort of thing. And then every so often, Joe Taylor drops another shiny thing into the ham radio community. The latest is FT8 and MSK441, and everybody goes, oh, and they rush off to this, and voila, we've got a whole nother way of communicating. So what's happening here is we're creating these new communities of hams. Hams are sort of reorganizing themselves in new ways to support these new modes, to support these new ways of operating, new ways of organizing, and the community is where the richness of all this is. You guys are sort of a community here. You get together, you have common interests. That doesn't mean this is your only interest, it just means you're a part of this community right now. Now, as we go through this, we have all these activities and procedures and publications, and by publications I mean any collected, curated bit of information, not just a pamphlet or a book. We're talking about videos, we're talking about podcasts, we're talking about streaming stuff, TV shows, all this stuff. We're basically moving into the 21st century is what we're doing, and we're dragging all this tradition up into the new century. What's going to happen to all that? Okay, so what is this transition? First of all, SDR is taking over the radio. Steve Hicks here, once the 2018 handbook comes out, you'll see a lot of Steve's handiwork and others. We're reworking the handbook. SDR is basically, in 5 years, you won't be able to buy an analog radio. You just won't. There's just no reason to do it. You're going to have everything from these little dongles all the way up to these big radios in the box. And right now we're thinking about SDR sort of from an analog perspective. We've used analog radios for years and years, and now this new technology has plopped itself down in front of us. So we're kind of mapping our old ways onto this new technology. Well, as we get used to that, SDR is going to enable whole new ways of thinking about radio and operating and the things that we want to do and the capabilities of the equipment. The digital modes, like I said, Joe Taylor drops another little shiny thing into the ball pit, and we jump on it immediately and try it out. There's new things on HF, there's new things on VHF and microwave. Another innovation comes out, and there's a router that does some new thing and overlaps some of the ham frequencies. So we reprogram that, and off we go. So the digital modes are really starting to expand, and they're moving beyond just the character, ting, 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 to a stream of audio, stream of data, stream of video, all this kind of stuff. We have massive amounts of processing power available to us now. Even the tiniest little Raspberry Pis have way more processing power than I had when I started out. You know, a lot of us have gone back to the day of the ASR33 and storing our stuff on paper tape. Those days are long gone, and there's really no excuse now to say, well, I can't get enough processing power on my board. That's just not a phrase you hear anymore. And you can compile directly to silicon now. Is Chris Testa here? There he is. Chris had this phrase that really captured me in 2015. He was talking about the white box, the handheld of tomorrow, and he says, you know, I needed a signal source, so I wrote a transmitter. And I went, what? I wrote a transmitter. It just blew my mind. And that is the new place where we're at. So we're focused on these systems. What can I do? What can I build? The Faraday RF that Sterling talked about yesterday in the Lightning talks, that is built specifically to create systems. It's a component, a very complicated component, but it is a component now that you can use to build these data systems that do different things. But it's still all about the community. Without a community to use it, expand it, put it to work, critique it, praise it, expand it, make it move, technology doesn't go anywhere. There's lots and lots of us that have all built some tiny little thing and it's really cool, but didn't go anyplace because there's no community to do it. Well, we have the tools with our online presence, social media, publications to build that community. And that's really where the richness is here. But, this is not all going to disappear into cyberspace. You still have to know how to radio, okay? You still have to know feed lines, and you have to know propagation, and you have to know what happens up there in the sky, and you have to know about tropo and multipath and all these other wonderful things that make radio either a total pain in the ass or extremely fun and exciting. And it's hard to tell the difference between the two in real time. It's only in the past that you can really tell this. And so radio know-how is still a key component to all of this, and that's what sets the big meta community apart, is we understand radio and wireless, even though we're doing things that look like just your basic network technology or maybe some little electronics. We know radio. Don't lose that. And another big question is, what is the FCC going to allow? There are some big RMs, rulemaking proposals that are out there hanging. We just got allowed, 630 meters and 2,200 meters. I don't think we're going to see too many handhelds for 2,200 meters. file your application, let any local user complain about it, they won't, and then get on and have fun. I have enough room to put up a full-size dipole for 630 meters down in Missouri. So I'm like, how am I going to do this? I'm going to use a drone. I'm going to all this kind of stuff. I'm going to be the guy with the full-size dipole. So that'll be good. That'll be a band on which having a full-size dipole will be a point of pride and bragging. So it's great. I operate a K3LR every year. It's like you go there. It's like, oh, my God, you can't believe it. Okay, so let's talk about ham radio 2.0. There are going to be lots and lots and lots of different communities. Now, I talked about in the first 100 years, if you got a copy of QST and it was about this big, it was about that thick, and you'd read it cover to cover and you'd get section news and, you know, DXing and all this kind of stuff, you would find out everything important there is going on and to know about ham radio in that month. Well, that doesn't work anymore. Ham radio is too big, too deep, and there's just all this stuff you cannot possibly know. The universe of ham radio is outside of any individual's light cone. You cannot physically understand it all. It's moving too fast. So there's going to be lots and lots and lots of different communities, and they're going to form, they're going to butt up against each other, they're going to overlap, they're going to merge, they're going to split. The old joke about if there's three hams in town, pretty soon there'll be two ham clubs. Well, it's yes, been there. Okay. Ham radio is going to attract all different levels of students. If you talk to people about new blood in ham radio, so, and they all focus in, so, well, you got to talk to the fifth graders. Oh, no, we got to talk to the middle schoolers. We got to talk. It's a high school. It's, you know, no, it's all of them. All of them. And we're really all students. As you know, once you get a tech license, it's like a learner's permit. That's like a license to learn. That's not, it doesn't particularly certify you for anything. It's like a novice license. It was just a little bit of hazing to see if you really wanted it. And then you would go and be hazed for 6 months to a year, you know, on 40 meter CW. And then after you didn't shock yourself to death or irritate all of the local hams, you would go on. So anyway, all levels of students will be involved. That's where our new blood is, I think, really. If we're talking about hams, those of us that you know, committed to the Church of Ham Radio and became nuns for Hiram, you know, back in the day, we did that when we were in high school, you know, when we were in junior high, when we were in college, and we committed for our whole lives. You know, we're all here. I see a lot of, you know, shiny pates, and I have plenty of gray hair, and I've been at this for 40 some years, and so have you. Okay, how do we get those people? The people that will stay with ham radio find some fascinating little element of it, and a lot of those are our students. We got the young adults, we got the free thinkers. They're all going to come. We need to attract them. They're going to make ham radio 2.0. Those of us that have been around for a while, we're going to have to help with this. We can't really drive that bus. As I said in my talk a couple years ago, we're going to have to let go, and that's kind of a hard thing. Public service is still going to be very, very important. No matter what the FCC says or does in its rulemaking stuff, the basis and purpose, Part 97.1A, is emergency communications. So public service is going to remain a keystone, fundamental of amateur radio. So we need to figure out how to take this techie stuff that's a lot of fun and map it onto the public good. We're going to come up with all kinds of weirdo applications that are just totally amazing and don't even exist right now. We're going to come up with systems that don't exist and aren't even imagined right now. This technology is going to sort of cross-fertilize, and somebody, some kid, you know, with a coding thing is going to sit down and code and create some amazing thing that's going to blow us all away. Maybe it's an old guy. You can be a kid at heart, you know, but sit down, code, build, test, get it out there. And it's all going to be built on evolving technology. You know, technology is moving so fast. I was talking to Scotty this morning, and he said, I would write articles about FPGA and SDR, but by the time I get the article out, it's obsolete. You know, the FPGAs are moving so fast. The technology for programming in them, the developing boards and everything, print is way too slow for that. You're going to have to get online. It's going to have to be a continuous kind of a process where you get on, you ask questions, you get input, you change, somebody else gives you some other input, and this moves, and then somewhere down the thread, somebody says, hey, they're releasing a revision to that development board. Can you port? And say, yeah, maybe I can port, and then something else happens, and then there's a new part. Nothing's going to stay still for a while. It's going to be built with the help of mentors. All of us that have been out here for a while are now mentors. It's our job to watch these things grow and, whether we're asked or not, help understand the radio part, help understand what made a system work or not work, understand all these things. We have all these scars from kittens or from our experiences about what we thought would work, what didn't work, what the mistakes were made. I know we learn from mistakes, but why do they always have to be mine? You know, okay, We're the mentors now. We're the elders of the tribe. We need to help these people be successful, explain things that they don't know, just be around. And that's all going to be built on top of this basic radio know-how stuff. Okay, the focus is going to be on technology. Hey, you've seen these guys. It's amazing. You know, I grew up on 6800 development boards, you know. It had maybe 1K of static RAM if you were lucky, and you could program 2716s and, you know, all this kind of stuff. I'm dating myself. These are astounding. Okay, so these are just what's there now. Okay, next week there's going to be something else, next month, next year. You got hamnet, okay? Grab these routers that happen to overlap our allocations, and we'll just repurpose them. We'll reflash them. I love it. Reflash them. Poof, you know, and they're a ham. So, hey, we've got this high-speed networking stuff. This reminds me very much of the old days when you got started in FM back in the 70s. You would go find a Motorola tube strip, you know, and or some tube radio, and then you would get the Wolf book, the big red Wolf book that Motorola politely stopped. Had them stop printing because it had all the cool schematics and stuff in it. And then you would carefully untune these things, and you would order crystal from international radio with the tube strip number and all this, and they would look up in their files, and you would get this little oven gadget, plug it in, and you would undo the helical filters until the little tuning slug was just about to come out because they only worked down to 148, and we were using them at 146, so you know there was just a little bit more. That was the reflashing of its day, and we felt just as excited and interested about it as we do now when we take one of these Linksys routers and hack the software to run on our channels and do ad hoc networking. That's exactly the same thing. It's the same topology of human behavior. It's just at a different technological layer. Hey, these are cool. The reverse beacon network, PSK reporter, WhisperNet, we have this automated network of receivers out there all around the world that are collecting 24/7, 365 signal reports. Anybody here run ViewProp? How about DX Maps? From EA6, okay. ViewProp has some more advanced features, but it's basically a mapping tool to take propagation reports and put them onto a geographic display. And you can watch the world evolve. I always use the phrase, you can listen to the world tune on ham radio. Well, these applications allow you to listen, watch the world turn, and you can see all these different contexts and stuff. I can't wait until I can play back the database of like CQ Worldwide and watch the world as the contest launches on Friday afternoon and suddenly becomes like a yarn ball of connections and all these different frequencies and stuff. These things are out there. They're collecting data. You'll hear Nathaniel talk about and his group talk about how many hundreds of thousands of observations these things made and dumped into the system. Nathaniel, are we over a million of...
Yeah, I think so.
1 million, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, observations made by these three networks during the solar eclipse QSO party and launched into a database that the professional guys are using. SDR, these are hybrids of internet and radio, and that some of the purists get really twitchy about that. Ignore them, okay? Let them twitch. SDR is changing from these little we've got everything from these little dongles that you can buy for $20, all the way up to real radios. You know, Flex worked this all out, but they still had to put a knob on it, right, Steve? You had to put a knob on it, okay? Got to have a knob. That's because of our mental model of what radio is. But this changes when you get this new user interface and you put it in front of a radio, and now you've got like waterfall display and other things and metadata, and these things are linked. This is a whole new way of thinking about radio. It's not just one long, one-dimensional string with little beads along the string, and the better our radio is, the more the beads it throws away. No, now we can see it all, And not only that, we can look at the bead, we can decode the bead, because these guys are out there, and we can tell who that bead is. And if we can tell who that bead is, we can use the internet to bring in all this metadata. And I can also look at the sun, the solar data, and I can say, where in this hemisphere is the signal likely to be coming from? Like, it's up there. I could put my face, somebody could put my face on this signal up there and see, because at this time of day, on this band, on this, you know, solar conditions, the angle of arrival is probably here. So I could look around, I could see the universe. I could see what my antenna farm sees. Simple matter of programming, the four most dangerous words in the English language. We're going to have to come up with modes to deal with noise and low signal noise ratio situations. I don't think the FCC is going to put the Chinese switching power supply back in the box. Do you? No. I don't think we're going to get all our neighbors Part 15'd up so that they have to clean up their wireless and their computer technology. Do you? No. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that horse is out of the barn. Pandora's horse is out of the box. I'll mix that metaphor. So we're going to have to come up with new modes to deal with this. FM was invented as a practical system back in the 20s by Major Armstrong, the super regenerative guy, to deal with atmospherics. Atmospherics was the term for static. Everything was AM at that point. And broadcasters and public service guys and all the stuff, they were having all these trouble because in the summer and these low frequencies that we're using, it was terrible. Well, FM came along and it solved that problem. It said, hey, this is all amplitude modulated noise. I'm just going to limit it, get rid of it, and all we've got left is modulation. Wow. And this was a huge, huge improvement. Nobody with an AM receiver could receive it, except maybe slope tuning or something like that. But it was a completely different modulation and model of radio. Okay, we can do the same thing. Noise, modes, low SNR, we can deal with it. It's like FT8. Routinely decodes at minus 12, minus 10 dB signal noise ratio. JT65, it's hit minus 30 plus and beyond. Can you believe it? You can't even see it on the waterfall display. And here it comes. We can do it. It's slow, but it's there. So let's work on that. And then we've got this big opportunity to deal with physical science. One of the things we're going to be working on is a personal space weather station that you can put in your backyard and collect this information. Who here has a personal weather station on Weather Underground? Okay, same thing. Exactly the same thing. We're just going to collect that same data. You're going to have your little space weather guy out there collecting data and get it into the researchers. This has been going on for 100 years. I wrote a book called History of QST, Volume 1, Technology, that details HAM's interaction with the professional research community over the last 100 years. There's a lot of it. Things are going to be changing. The new model for operating is going to be out and about. It's not going to be the big fixed station in your house with a big tower in the backyard. That is less and less and less common, for a whole variety of reasons, okay? I'm sure you can guess at what they are. People are now operating mobile. They're operating portable. They're operating low power. Remote control is changing everything on HF, DXing, and contesting. There's this huge holy wars raging right now about remote control. And is it okay? Is it not okay? How do we control it? What are the rules? Stealth operating, well, we all know about stealth operating and how it's easier to ask forgiveness than permission, and temporary really means just until I die, but, okay. Stealth is important. All these things, mobile, portable stuff, you can't demand that people commit to have this giant station in their house anymore. Okay, the modality of the station is now going to be something like this. So people are forming clubs and maker-like spaces. How many makerspace members have we got here? Aren't they fun? Aren't they cool? Okay, so ham radio can do the same kind of thing, build a station, work in the station. This used to be the norm, and it's very common in Europe to have a club station that everybody works at that's off in this good location, and it's up on a hill and all this kind of stuff. And so we're going to share these systems that we build to support this kind of thing. There are a lot of really non-traditional, goat portable? No, I don't know. I only see one up there, so maybe he lost his goat 2 kit. That's good. Yeah, all right, you're awake. Okay, cool. This is Steve. I forget what his last name is. Steve Galchett, and he uses pack goats. He participates in Summits on the Air, which is a program where you have to haul the gear the last mile or so. You can drive up, but then you gotta walk it up. QRP, obviously, and so he gets up on these 14,000-foot peaks with the goats, and away he goats, so to speak. It's a very popular program. National Parks on the Air, you've got IOTA, Islands on the Air, all these things support these new modes of operating. But the focus has to be on relationships, because that's what kind of holds us together. There's got to be at least 2 hams, right? I mean... Yeah, so at least 2. Okay, so you've got to have more than one. Ham radio contests are a very unusual sport in that you only get points by cooperating with your competitor. I don't know of any other sport where you do that. Okay, so communication. There's got to be somebody on the other end, and so that defines the relationship. The system is nothing. What did Metcalf say? That the power of the network is not in the speed, it's the number of people that are connected together by it. Okay, so that is what we have to remember as we build these wonderful systems. The more people we get involved with this, the more perspective, the more functions, the more utility it has, and that builds a group. Okay, that when we build a device, we need to realize that there needs to be a group to use the device. So not only are you innovating, you know, with compiling and linking, who links anymore? Nobody links. That's old talk. When you're compiling to silicon or whatever, you got to remember that there's a people group that's also out there. And that builds a community. And then the community of JT65 users, the WSJT community, is enormous. It's changed everything for Moonbounce. Absolutely everything for Moonbounce. I have a picture of a guy, OK1, can't remember what his call sign. He's one of the big OK1 EME guys. He's got this little receiver. It's sitting in his apartment in Prague. And he's got a little whip, a little 70-centimeter whip, about this long, and it's sitting on top of the radio, and through the window, you can see the moon, okay? And he is decoding EME from Arecibo. They had the big dish on, and so here's this guy with this little tiny whip getting a decode of JT65. It's just amazing. So that's changing everything. All these people who were locked out before, you had to build this 30-foot monstrosity in your backyard, and that's great. I my hat is off to those guys, but now we have a community. We have an EME community, believe it or not, and that's launching itself out into all these other things. So get together online. It's never been easier. You make a Yahoo group or whatever. You announce it. Poof, you have a community. That's great. People will sign up. They will start abusing each other, and you have to throw some out, you know, but that's just humans, okay? That's how primates behave, you know, the bell curve. Okay, so then get together physically. This is a lot of fun here because it's one thing to be chatting away on email or something. It's another thing entirely to get together and have a beer, and the conversation just kind of goes and goes and goes, and somebody else wanders over, and boom, 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 boom. You can't do that online yet. That's probably a good thing, okay? But get together physically and have fun together. That's what keeps us coming back. And then you sustain your community. You nurture it. You take care of it. You moderate it. You feed it. You take care of the needs of the humans that are involved, okay? That sustains it, keeps it going, and then it bumps up against other communities. It's like the Earth, Moon, Earthers bumped up against the VHF contesters, which bumped up against the meteor scatter guys, which bumped up against the HF guys, and the HF guys bumped up against the gritty guys, you know, and it's all these things, all these pyramids, as they grow, their bases get wider. And as the bases get wider, they bump up with the other pyramids. And so this is a very cool thing. Build your community and don't be afraid of interacting, because that's where the richness comes. And don't forget the fun part. It can't all be about the code. I mean, the code is fun, and I certainly spent my 24-hour periods deep into the structure, having a great time, and suddenly it's 2 days later. You know, I remember giving my kids some Dungeons and Dragons stuff from the 70s and having on one of the Dungeon Master note sheets, it's like 10 a.m., day two. You know, it's like, okay, whoa, Dad, what's all this about? No, never mind. Okay. It can't all be about the code. You've got to have fun. So when somebody innovates and brings something new, you got to celebrate it. Have fun with it. If you're the bringer, you got to accept that people are going to have fun with it. And it may not be approached with the appropriate reverence at all times. Okay, it's a two-way street. And drill holes in and break stuff. Void your warranty. That's the hacker ethic, right? You know, I hesitate to say this because it's emotionally threatening to people, but in Ham Radio 2.0, no one will care about the original shipping containers. I thought about starting a business called Original Shipping Containers, you know. And people, you know, it's so funny, you know. The radio, yeah, that's all these. Yeah, how much does it cost and everything? Well, you have the original boxes, you know. It's like, oh, no, I'm sorry. You know, that's the end of the deal. It's just one of our strange little behaviors of many. Drill holes in and break stuff, build things, hack stuff together, and then get out there and compete and compare. The microwave update has a antenna shootout. The VHF conferences have antenna shootouts. We have competitions. We have contests. We have our little award programs and stuff like that. Innovate there, too. Build up different things. One of the things that the Solar Eclipse QSO party featured was you got extra bonus points for being spotted in grids every hour. I think every hour, wasn't it, Nate, we're going to go through. And if you were spotted in EM 48, you got a point. And then an hour later, during that next clock hour, if you were spotted in EM 48 again, you got another point. So it wasn't whether you made contacts or not. It's whether you were able to broadcast your signal over a wide area. So this is kind of a new thing, these coverage kind of competitions. Parties, picnics, hikes, hamfest, get out there, do stuff, have fun, move. I realize for some of us that's life-threatening, but you got to get out of the basement, guys. You know, get out of the basement, go down the street all alone, you know, like the song says. You know, you got to go look up Rovin' by the Spurious Emissions Band. It's a takeoff on the Grateful Dead truck, and you'll enjoy it. The words are out there. Use existing hamfests and conventions. The QRPers have 4 days in May. They all get together, they rent a hotel, the Holiday Inn Fairfield, I think, and they have a QRP mini hamvention for a couple of days, and then everybody gets turned loose on Saturday, and they go buy stuff and go out to the hamvention and stuff. If you've got a new community, bring your community to an existing hamfest, do your own little thing a day before or the first day, and then join in with everybody else. And that brings everybody together, and it also fertilizes your group and their group as well. Pizza. I was going to put beer on here, but, you know, we're not all drinking age. Pizza Fest, just get together and eat, have fun, knock yourself out. Here's some fun examples. Okay, youngsters on the air. How many people are aware of Yoda? And I'm not talking about the guy with the ears. Okay, Youngsters on the Air is a European group. And when they say youngsters, it means something different over here. Over here, it means children. Over there, it means young adults and mid-level students, say 15 to 25. These guys and gals get together and they have conventions and all sorts of stuff. I mean, look at this. This is they're having a lot of fun. This looks like Dayton 50 years ago when we used to go and hang out and irritate the old guys. Ages 15, 25, more or less. They have a big presence in Europe. They're starting one in Japan. Why we do not have one here in Region 2, I don't know. We're working on it. Sterling, you went to Yoda 2015, right?
2016.
How much fun was it?
It was the greatest thing. As a young man, it was amazing.
It's just amazing, yes. And the drinking age in Europe is like... Everybody had a great time. A great time. They have special call signs. The FCC, nah, we can't get special call signs. We can get the little one by ones. Over there, you can get OE2017YOTA. And if you want a thrill, get into a big contest with a call sign like that. But you can get special call signs, which are always fun, activity, you're rare for a weekend or a week, whatever. You have in-person conventions every year. Right now, they're having one every year in Europe. We're trying to organize one over here. The Japanese are going to try one in Region 3. And then we have to let the people organizing and going to these things do whatever they want, okay? Help them have this stuff and then get out of the way, okay, and see what they do. They also have operating events, little contests, competitions, all sorts of fun things. Here's another one. Collegiate Amateur Radio Initiative, C-A-R-I. It's got a Facebook page, and this one is all about college clubs, okay? How many people were in a college radio club? How many people flunked out because they spent too much time in the college radio club? I used to joke I got my bachelor's in Tripoli, W0 Tripoli. I spent like 600 hours down there one year just on the air, you know? How I managed to graduate, I just... Don't ask. Okay. So, hey, they're having fun. They're doing neat things. They're going out, they're having parties, they're doing fun things on the air, they're innovating, they're building, all this kind of stuff. Cool, cool, cool. The clubs are all connected on social media. They have a page on Facebook. They're sharing their successes. How did you get your club back on the air? How did you get space from the administration? How do you guys get access to the roof? You know, all this kind of stuff. And they're sharing all these things so they don't have to do it all their own. Some long dormant calls are coming back on the air after decades of inactivity. W9, Yankee Tango, one of the great University of Wisconsin radio club call signs. I used to run chess matches with them from W0 Triple E with Purdue and U of I and all this kind of stuff. And the faculty advisor smoked these big green cigars in the back. It was awful, but we made him sit in the back. It was okay. The clubs recruit, they build on social media. That's how they attract attention. That's where the other students come from. And whammo, you've got a new little community. We're starting to talk about, couldn't we build some competitions that college clubs would like to engage in? Sort of a league from, you know, like a college league or something. How are we doing here? Okay, we're getting running about out of time. Okay, and one more fun example. Thank you, Steve. Ham Science Citizen Investigation. You've heard a lot about it. You're going to hear a lot more about it this afternoon. These people have lab coats, ladies and gentlemen, real lab coats, and they're not afraid to wear them. This was the Ham Sci booth at Dayton. They're out there operating during the eclipse. They're doing balloons. I mean, it's an amazing thing. It's just starting out. We just started to do the eclipse QSO party. It was organized around the eclipse. But it's got undergrads, it's got graduates, got postdoc, got faculty, and it's now attracting serious scientists from various facilities. Look for more, and we can pile in as digital people into this. They've got an online community, it's branching out, it's bumping up to the Society of Amateur Radio Astronomers. Did you even know there was such a thing? S-A-R-A? They're sharing papers, posters, projects. This is the real deal. Okay, so you got to sustain critical mass. You got to share your cross connections, okay? Then you build interest. Then you stimulate some ideas and brainstorming, and that attracts more people, and just, you know, rinse and repeat, and you just go and go and go, and these things evolve, okay? Evolution is good. You're not trying to just put a stick in the sand and then defend it, okay? You put this stuff together and let it go. Okay, say, how far will it go? Don't be isolated. Don't worry about your little tribe losing members or something like that, or people coming from the outside. That's where the richness is, okay? And don't be afraid to change. Say you put something together and you get it out there and you start doing it. It's like the JT65 begat JT9. Okay, well, JT9 was doing some pretty cool things for the HF community, and then there was some back and forth, and hey, we got JTX, and then there was JT8 or FT8, and all of a sudden, boom, you know. But if Joe had put his arms around that and said, nope, only JT65, stay away from my baby, that would never happen. You have to allow this to move, and that's a sign of respect. A sign of disrespect is when people ignore you, okay? When they show up and they want to mess with your stuff, that's respect. Okay, so here's my advice. If it's legal, try it, okay? Publicize it. Don't wait for the ARL or Tapper or AMSAT or something to bless your invention. Just do it, okay? Demonstrate that it has value or find out that it does not. Deal with the existing communities and make your space. Free yourselves from traditional FDMA planning. Band plans are strangling the hobby below 50 megahertz, below 2 meters, really. Okay, you've got this little JT tribe claims and will fiercely defend, okay, their tiny little 1.5 kilohertz slice of something. The Whisper guys, or they're defending their turf. The slow scan television people have been, they remind me of the people that you see where a highway comes and it goes around this little farm and then it comes back together. There they are in the middle of the highway medium complaining about the noise, okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we have the ability to find ourselves across wide swaths of spectrum. Use SDR to look at the signals and say, oh, there's another slow scan television signal. It's way over there. It's not on 14230. It's on whatever. Go there. We don't have to we're not using crystals anymore, okay? But the modality is still there. Hybridize immediately. Connect the internet to whatever you're doing immediately and get it out there and widely. That immediately takes everything worldwide. Reutilize on-the-air events that already exist. Don't worry about creating your own event so much unless you absolutely have to. If there's a contest that you kind of like a VHF contest, and you want to make it about mountain topping or whatever, make your own contact. Make the contacts count in that existing contact, and then get out there and do it. You'll increase the participation. The sponsors will like it. Your people will be out there finding other people to contact. They'll enjoy it. So I call it a contest within a contest. Do this. Provide public service information. Figure out how your invention, how your tribe can fulfill 97.1A and perform public service. That's important. It's an important and a keystone aspect of our hobby. We're not just basement tinkerers. We exist in this space. We get access to this space. The quid pro quo is that we have to provide some public service. So get out there and interact. Soak up all this know-how from the existing experts. If you're an existing expert, and who doesn't think they are, okay, don't be afraid to contribute. Wait in there, get busy. If you don't know something, ask. And ignore the trolls and the grouches, okay? This is the internet age. We all know they're out there. Just don't engage. Don't feed the trolls. Don't let them dump cold water on your stuff. If it's legal, try it and publicize it. Okay, the future is here. It's just not very evenly distributed. William Gibson, absolutely true. And this one really blows me away. When I say the word future, the first syllable already belongs to the past. Okay, that's like when I develop a device or a program, it's already obsolete. That's what that means, okay? So, in summary, go for it, okay? Ham Radio 2.0 is here. The transition is happening. We're happy. We're excited. We've got the tools. We've got resources we couldn't have dreamed of when we were just starting out. I don't really have time for Q&A. I think the big red hook is coming out here. But thank you very much. I'd be happy to talk to you after the show. 73.
All right, let's get Scotty ready.
Oh, is Scotty the next
person? Scotty's the next person.
What's my call sign anyway? Oh, yeah, that's right.